Hello guys, a very good morning to all of you. I welcome you all in this video of current affairs that is helpful for your RBI SEBI NABARD phase 1 GK examination. So let's quickly begin this video, but before that, if you haven't subscribed to our channel, then do subscribe and hit the bell notification. And guys, the PDF of this session will be provided to you on our Telegram channel, which you can join by using the link given in the description below. So let's begin this video, where we have the first question from the Freedom on the Net report. So which of the following statements is incorrect about the Freedom on the Net 2021 report? Option A, over 3.8 billion people have access to the internet. 75% of world's internet population live in countries where individuals have been killed or attacked for their online activities since June 2020. More than 60 countries were assessed based on 9 key internet controls. India ranks among 55 other countries that have investigated, arrested or convicted people for their social media posts. India used 8 internet control measures between May 2020 and June 2021. So out of these 5 options, the right statement, the right option is 75%, because here the percentage is wrong. It is not 75 but 72% of this world's internet population is living in countries where individuals have been killed or attacked for their online activities. So let's have a look in this report in detail. Okay, so the very first thing that you need to know about this report is that it is released by Freedom House, which is a US-based non-profit organization. Okay, this report has assessed more than 60 countries on 9 key internet control measures. Which country imposes more internet controls, or which country has imposed less internet controls, is something that is judged in this report. However, you need to understand this thing, that there is no ranking given to any country because this is a report, not an index. Okay, so keep this thing in your mind. Now let's have a look at the global scenario. What is happening around the world? So as per this report, internet freedom has deteriorated for the 11th year consecutively. For the past 11 years, internet freedom, which also defines your right to express, the right to expression, the right to express yourself on social media, has been curbed by governments across the countries across the world. Okay, so that is something which is happening around the world at present, and it is highlighted by this report. The next point is that the greatest deterioration have been seen in countries like Myanmar, Belarus and Uganda. So all of these countries are facing internal disturbances like election crisis or constitutional crisis. So in the wake of these crises, in the wake of the internal disturbances, a greater control over internet expression, internet access has been there in countries like Myanmar, Uganda and Belarus. China has ranked as the worst country giving its internet rights, as the worst environment for internet freedom across the world for a 7th consecutive year. So we all know how much freedom China gives to its citizens. So this is a very, we can say, empirical statement, because we all know that the statement is very true and very obvious. Next is that governments in at least 48 countries attempted to suppress online dissent by pursuing new rules for tech companies on content, data and competition in the past year. So this is very similar to what we have already seen, the data protection law. However, the data protection law is very much in the national interest of India. But there are certain laws, there are certain provisions in different acts. For example, the new digital rules. We will be talking about them later on when we talk about the India scenario. But I'm just giving you an example of India here so that you can relate better. So the new digital rules are also there, which also talk about data, which also talk about the competition and the content. So all of these are being regulated by different countries, and these become a mode of suppressing the mode of the freedom of expression on social media or on internet medium. This statement we have already read. Nearly 72% of the world's internet population live in countries where individuals have been killed or attacked for their online activities since June 2020. Now, let's discuss about India's scenario. So, India is among the 45 countries. So, there is a list of 45 countries. Basically, there is no actual list. You need to understand this thing that there is a group of 45 countries that are accused of using spywares on their own citizens. So now I think that you are remembering something, right? Pegasus. So it was a huge ruckus when the news related to Pegasus spyware broke in India. Okay, so this is very evident that India is in the list of the countries which are using spywares to investigate their own journalists, their own opposition leaders, their own citizens, so that the dissent, that is the disagreement with the present government, can be suppressed beforehand, even before it takes the shape of a protest or something like that. Okay. So this statement is saying that, and not only India, Nigeria, Hungary, Mexico, Myanmar, all of these countries are the same, okay, when it comes to spying their own citizens. Internet control measures that India has implemented are social media blocking of social media, deliberate disruption of communication networks. So this is similar that is happening in Kashmir. Manipulation of online discussions by pro-government commentators, introduction of a new law increasing surveillance and restricting anonymity between May 2020 and June 2021. So these are some of the measures that have been taken by the Indian government in order to suppress the freedom of expression of citizens on online medium, on social media. Now, the new law that is being talked about here is the new digital rules. If you remember, there was a great hype when these new digital rules came out because of these rules, Facebook also had a dispute with the government. So what did these rules say? These rules say that you have to catch the originator of the social media message if the message is inappropriate according to government, or if the message is such that is promoting hatred or communal violence or internal disturbance, then we will catch the first originator, the originator of this message. So this is clearly restricting anonymity. If you can't post something anonymously, if you will get caught eventually, then obviously there is no anonymity and surveillance is also increased. However, this is a good step as far as it is restricting the manipulation of data, it is restricting the harassment of normal citizens. But what does the government say? That it is inappropriate. It is not necessary that it is inappropriate in actuality. Okay, so that is something over which Facebook also fought with the government, that this inappropriate cannot be called inappropriate. You have to define this inappropriate term. So that was a huge dispute. In fact, India ranks among the 55 other countries that have investigated, arrested or convicted people for their social media posts, especially on WhatsApp, Facebook, YouTube and Twitter. So this is also something that we have already heard about. There is nothing new. So this is the situation of India, and we need to acknowledge this thing that yes, India is also not a free country anymore, especially if we are talking about the internet freedom. Next is this, basically this is the screenshot of the summary or the fact sheet of this report. So over 3.8 billion people have access to internet. Out of these 3.8 billion internet users or internet population of the world, 75% live in countries where individuals were arrested or imprisoned for posting content on political, social and religious issues. 72% live in countries where individuals have been attacked or killed for their online activities. 64% live in countries where authorities deployed pro-government commentators to manipulate online discussions. So in the 64% people, we also come. The Indian population also come. 56% live in countries where political, social or religious consent was blocked online. 46% live in countries where access to social media platforms was temporarily or permanently restricted. 41% live in countries where authorities disconnected internet or mobile networks, often for political reasons. So this is the global scenario. Now let's discuss the question number two. Which agency has launched India COVID response program for agricultural transition? US International Development Finance Corporation, International Finance Corporation, United States Agency for International Development, both A and B, both A and C. So the right answer is option E, both A and C. So both of these US organizations have launched this program that aims to help the farmers to get recover from the COVID-19's economic impact. Okay, now how are they going to do that? Let's discuss that. So the very first thing is that the corpus of this project, the corpus of this entire program is $55 million. Okay, and this is an 8-year program. So this program will run for 8 years. Now guys, you have to understand this thing, that what is the focus, what is the purpose of this program. So this program basically aims to increase the income of farmers, particularly the small farmers or women farmers. Okay, how are they going to increase the income of farmers? By increasing the reach of farmers to the markets. Secondly, by promoting clean technologies in agriculture. Now if the clean technologies become rampant, then the cost of using the technology, the cost of using the clean energy would reduce, and thus it will reduce the overall cost of production for the farmers. Plus it is climate friendly as well. So the basic purpose of this program is to increase the income of farmers in agriculture by promoting clean energy sources among the farmers or in the agriculture. Okay, so this is the basic purpose. And this is the similar statements that I have taught you. Next is, now the $55 million, where will it be used? So it will be used for supporting loans to farmer producer organization, agritech companies, companies engaged in clean energy solutions for the agriculture sector. The aim is to reach 2 lakh smallholder farmers in India, and not only the US agencies but UK's Foreign Commonwealth and Development Office, all of these are supporting this program. Technical assistance to this program will be provided by the Rabo Foundation, which is a Netherlands based foundation. Loans to FPOs will be provided by the 3 Indian lenders. So these are the 3 Indian organizations that will be dealing with the farmers directly. Obviously, USAID, the organization, would not come to India to give loans. They would hire the Indian organizations to further give the loans. So these are the 3 Indian organizations that have been chosen by the US agencies for this program. I hope that this program is now clear to you. Let me write it down. Promoting agriculture or increasing the income of farmers by promoting the use of clean energy in agriculture. So clean energy and agriculture, these two are the focus areas of this program. Okay, if you see the word transition, this is clearly highlighting the focus on the clean energy. Moving on to the next question, which city has been chosen as the UNESCO World Book Capital for 2023? The right answer is option D, Accra, which is the capital of Ghana. So this has been chosen as the World Book Capital for 2022. Guadalajara Guadalajara is not the capital of Mexico. It is a very big city in Mexico. So it is the World Book Capital for 2022. Tbilisi, which is the capital of Georgia, it is the World Book Capital for 2021. And Madrid, Spain, was the first city which was named as the World's Book Capital in 2001. So all of these are clear facts that you need to know and memorize for your examination. Now, the World Book and Copyright Day is observed on April 22, and in the light of this day only, in order to celebrate this day, the World Book Capitals are announced by the UNESCO. At UN High Level Dialogue on Energy 2021, India has announced to implement National Hydrogen Energy Mission to scale up annual green hydrogen production to dash million tons by 2030. So the right answer here is 1 million ton. Guys, you need to understand that recently United Nations General Assembly has taken place. So the 76th session of that assembly, UNGA, has recently taken place. Abdullah Shahid, who is also the foreign minister of Maldives, was the president of this 76th session of UNGA. So these are the facts. Now, during the session, Prime Minister Narendra Modi announced some targets for India in the field of energy. So what are the energy targets of India that have been announced by Prime Minister Narendra Modi during the UNGA? The very first thing that we are going to discuss here is the theme of UNGA 2021, that is building resilience through hope to recover from COVID-19, rebuild sustainably, respond to the needs of the planet, respect the rights of people, and revitalize the United Nations. So this is the theme. Do remember the theme. Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi has announced that India will achieve its 450 gigawatts of target by 2030. And we are very close to achieving the 175 gigawatt of target by 2022, according to the Ministry of Power and Ministry of Renewable Energy. UN High Level Dialogue on Energy. So the very first thing about this dialogue is that it took place for the first time in 40 years. Okay, so that makes it all the more important for you. Now, during this energy dialogue, India has announced very important commitments. India has announced very important targets in relation to the energy, clean energy. Guys, do pay attention to it, because these can become direct questions in your upcoming exams. So the very first target or the commitment that India has made is that it will implement the National Hydrogen Energy Mission that was announced in the budget this year, and increase the annual green hydrogen production to 1 million tons by 2030. Very important target. Next, a commitment that India has made is India will launch the production linked scheme, incentive scheme, in the field of solar PV manufacturing. So PLI scheme for solar PV, guys, this has already been launched. So what the commitment does India make here? The commitment is that India will increase the capacity to 10 gigawatts, solar PV manufacturing capacity to 10 gigawatt via this PLI scheme for solar PVs. Okay. 15 MMT production capacity of compressed biogas by 2024. MMT, million metric tons. So 15 million metric tons production of biogas by 2024. This is another target. 20% ethanol blending in petrol by 2025 to 2026. So this is the clear target that we have been discussing for ages now. Enhance energy efficiency in agriculture, buildings, industry, transport sector, and promote energy efficient appliances and equipment to reduce country's emission intensity of GDP by 33 to 35%. So guys, this is the part of the nationally determined contributions that India has set for itself under the Paris Agreement. So this is another commitment. Basically, the commitments are not at all new commitments. But India has just said that we are going to fulfill the targets that we have already set. So in light of this UN high level dialogue on energy, or in light of the statements that Prime Minister has said in the dialogue, all these targets become all the more important. The next point is that more than $400 billion investment is committed by the governments and private sector in clean energy. Annual investment in clean energy and in energy efficiency is, so annual investment in clean energy and energy efficiency required to achieve net zero emissions by 2050 is estimated to be $4.4 trillion. So basically what this statement is saying, that we need this much investment in order to achieve net zero emissions by 2050. So that was all about the United Nations high level dialogue on energy. Who has been appointed as the external auditor to the International Atomic Energy Agency? The right answer is G.C. Murmu, the Controller Auditor General of India. Option B is the right answer. Okay, so he has been appointed as the external auditor for 6-year terms from 2022 to 2027. Which of the following hydropower projects has won the Blue Planet Prize given by International Hydrogen Association? The right answer is Tista 5th Power Station. Now guys, this Blue Planet Award is very important for hydropower projects because it is given to those projects which are sustainable, which are made and which are operating by keeping the sustainable development goals in point of in viewpoint. Okay, so this has been developed by NHPC. The capacity of this power plant is 510 megawatts. It is built on Teesta River, that's why it is named as Teesta 5th Power Station. It is located in Sikkim. So all of these facts are important that you need to remember. So it has won this Blue Planet Prize given by International Hydrogen Association, and it was given during the World Hydropower Congress 2021. It was held virtually, so there is no question of the venue. Next is that IHA is a London-based non-profit organization which is currently operating in 120 countries. IHA Blue Planet Prize, I have already told you, is given to the projects that demonstrate excellence in sustainable development. Now, hydropower sustainability assessment protocol is the protocol that is used to judge different projects and their sustainability. 2021, IHA Mosoni Award for Excellence in Hydropower has been awarded to Richard Taylor, who is the CEO of IHA, this International Hydropower Association. So guys, that was all for today. I hope that you have understood all that I have taught you today. Thank you so much. And if you want the PDF, then do subscribe to our Telegram channel.